If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It sorry says 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes.
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed. A child shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
A child.
I know.
What's up, Jay Watcher?
Okay.
A Twitter person?
Yeah. A watcher. 666. Okay, Mark Dining, Teen Angel, is up next. Shout out to Revo for bringing this awesome stream to us. This song was written by Gene Dining and was inspired by a news article on delinquent teens. It was released by MGM Records in October of 1959. This song was banned, really, by many radio stations in the U.S. and entirely in the U.K. by the BBC because of it being too sad. I'm pretty sure I've heard this song.
Yeah, I told you they didn't know how to deal with negative emotions at the time.
I'm pretty sure I heard this song, and I'm pretty sure that my sister would listen to this song. But I thought it was about like Sweet 16 sort of thing. Like I didn't know it had any sadness to it. So I guess I didn't listen to it. If it's the song I'm thinking of, despite this, it became a huge hit, reaching number one in the U.S. What?
Wow.
It was banned from the radio stations in 1959.
Please,
how did they hear about it? If it was not on the radio stations, how did it become number one?
I don't know.
Its success inspired a whole bunch of these teenage death tragedy songs that were major hits for most of the 1960s.
Oh my God.
Wow. Banning sad songs sounds insanely strange to us today, especially in rock and metal community where sad songs are not only the norm, but demanded.
You gotta have them.
This could be a cornerstone moment in that shift. This is another performance on the TV show American Bandstand with host Dave Clark. Wow, that's so wild. Yeah, we actually have a sad stream coming up. I think it's, negative vibes by negative vibes. I think that's next week.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Negative vibes by negative. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That should be interesting. All right, guys, here
okay,
we go.
Okay, so guys, Mark Dining, Teen Angel.
All right, let's check it out.
I'm pretty sure I've heard this.
You know, it's a rare thing when a song reaches the top 10 sellers and is a ballad and reaches there in a very short length of time. This is one of the most stirring ballads of the day. It's done by a man whose family's been making music for years and years. He is the younger brother of the famous Dinning sisters. Ladies and gentlemen, the song is called Teen Angel. Here is Mark Dinning.
Ah. Sounds like a funeral.
That fateful night, the car was stalled upon the railroad track. I pulled you out and we were safe, but you went running back. Teen What was it you were looking for that took your life that night? They said they found my high school ring clutched in your fingers tight. Just sweet 16, and now you're gone. They've taken you away. I'll never kiss your lips again. They buried you today. Teen angel, can you hear me? Teen angel, can you see? Are you somewhere up above? And am I still your own true love? Teen angel, teen angel, answer me, please.
I definitely have not heard that one, and that was not the song I was thinking of. Do you know which one I'm talking about?
No. I have no idea what you're talking about.
It was more of a... All I remember is Teen Angel. But that is not... I've never heard this song before. What a sad song. She went back for his ring.
Yeah. They said they found my high school ring clutched in your fingers tight.
Because he had already taken her out of the car, so they were going to make it. And then she ran back for his ring.
Yeah, it is. It's very fascinating that they would not allow this to be played in the radio. Shout out to JLB. I just think that... I think people have a very, very hard time. Not only with the concept of tragedy, but the concept of death. And not only the concept of death, but the concept of dying young as a teenager.
She's 16.
I just think that that's especially when you think about, again, the Great Depression, particularly World War II. World War II, which would have been more recent in the zeitgeist. World War II would have been more... And what happened in World War II? It was almost exclusively young men in their teenage years dying.
Yeah.
Doing the killing and doing the dying. And so I can understand them saying, man, we ain't trying to hear that shit. We just got out of a world war where like hundreds of millions of people perished.
Yeah.
And on top of that, now we've got this, you know, beef with this emerging superpower, the USSR. So I can understand the older generation saying, nah, we ain't trying to hear that shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're not trying to hear anything that's going to bring you down even more than you're already brought down. And on top of that, teenagers are so they're so influenced by their emotions that, you know, they end up doing... Like, I remember, like, I won't listen to it, and I still to this day won't... we've never reviewed it. We probably never will. Unless there's, like, a real serious... push for it. But there's this song by Blink-182 that I was listening to heavy that was not good for me to listen to. Like, I shouldn't have been listening to it as a teenager. I was in a lot of trouble listening to that song. So
but would you put this in that category though?
Well, it would have been the only version of a song like that for young people. You see what I'm saying? It
sounds
like they had a bunch of options that was talking about...
Yeah, but to me, this song doesn't... I don't see that this song would instigate self-harm or something like this. To me, that's more a precautionary tale. Don't go back for the ring. You had him. He was right there.
Yeah, you're speaking logically, but you're forgetting what it's like to be a teenager that's just completely caught up in their emotions. So I understand what you're saying logically, looking back at it from almost 100 years later, sure. But if you're a teenager in that period of time and this shit is not talked about in open public, as you know, like we talk to our kids about, hey, if you're depressed, if you're this, if you're that, like we have open conversations about that. But if you didn't have those conversations with your parents and that was your only outlet,
yeah,
then yeah, it could have some real negative effects on you as far as how you, you know, deal with that, deal with that song or how you relate to that song. In the Soviet Union, 63% of all Soviet males born in 1923 were dead by 1946.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. I mean, the Soviets took... what did I tell you? Like, you know, when I had that discussion on Middle America and I said to that person, thank God we had the Soviets around to beat those Nazis for us. Because the Soviets paid the heaviest price in overcoming the Nazis. Mm-hmm. I mean, they lost more people than Jews were killed in concentration camps. Like... they paid a heavy, 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 heavy price. So it was just a horrible time period to come out of. So if you come out of that time period, you're not trying to hear, you're not trying to play that shit or hear that shit. You fought, as a matter of fact, a lot of these people's parents fought in World War II. Mm-hmm. So you fought so that your kid could have a happy-go-lucky, you know, life when you didn't even think about any of that shit and you never thought about the suffering in the world because you lived in your nice little American cloister.
Yeah.
That's the goal.
Yeah.
That was the goal.
Yeah.
So I understand why they wanted to shut down, but the problem is if you shut it down, it's obviously...
Well, look what it did. It became a number one.
Yeah, it blew up because tragedy... Whoa. Young people need to learn how to process tragedy.
Yeah, and literally, if this is like one of the only songs that was out, then it makes sense that it became such a hit because, you know, they want some explanation for things, and that makes sense. It just it made it blow up more. I'm sure they wouldn't play it, and that it was kind of like hush hush.
And because death, especially among young people, is a part of life, and I'm sure all those. You know, you always know. So you know what's really interesting? When I was in the hood, like, people would die. You know, you get jammed up, you get caught up in something or whatever, people would die. When I came to Maine, and I went into the school, one of the first things I saw was this wall, and it was a wall of people that died in car accidents. I'm like, holy shit. Because we were taking public transportation. Mm-hmm. And my big thing was, you know, I just wanted to stay away from the Bloods. In Harlem at 12 at night, like that. That was my big thing. I was always like, "Look, there's certain places, certain time. Like, I can't go here. I can't go here. Like, I'm good." You know what I'm saying? Like, as far as other stuff goes. But when I came to Maine, and I saw there's a whole fucking wall. It was like the CIA. You know, they got the Wall of Honor there, the agency. Like, it was like that. I was like, "Holy shit!" And sure enough, on Christmas Eve. You get four guys. They all. I was supposed to play football with those kids. Cause Christmas was on a Monday. Mm-hmm. Christmas Eve was on a Sunday. I get a phone call after church. It's Sunday, and there's all this yelling and screaming in the background, and they're like, "Yo, Matt didn't make it." And I'm like, "I'm like, oh, that's cool. We'll just play without him." Cause I thought, cause we were all supposed to play on Monday at the field. And they're like, "Nah, man, there was an accident." And, you know, there was some black ice. There was no fucking black ice. They got high and drunk and fucking got behind the wheel. They're fucking 78 miles an hour. Everybody died. The dog, everybody. And I just remember coming to... I remember because one of the kids that died used to work for me. Mm-hmm. So I remember driving to work and pulling up the last thing he did just so I could hear him. You know what I'm saying? Like... And I couldn't believe it. That was Dorian's first Christmas. I was like, I didn't know what to do. Because all these people were calling me. How could God let this happen? Blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, these are all... You know, they used to make fun of me. They used to call me preacher or whatever. But, you know, when shit like that happened, like... I remember going... I remember going to the... it was ridiculous. Mm-hmm. One of the guys, the main guy that got behind the wheel, when my brother graduated, he like walked right by me. He's in my brother's Mike Knorr. He's in my brother's graduating class and shit. The kid walked right by me when my brother went up to graduate and shit. Like, I still have the picture of the day that my brother graduated. It's me, my junior, and Jamie. And it's the one where I've got the, like, Reese's thing in my hand. That was, like, I never forget that day. All those kids, every single one of them are dead. I couldn't believe it. So, like, they gotta have, young people need an outlet for...
They
need to have an outlet for expressing that grief. And they need to be told, hey, you're gonna lose people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's just how it is. You know what I'm saying?
I think that Revo is correct, too. These young people also had to deal with the death of some of their stars. Like Buddy Holly earlier this year, there has to be a way that they can process it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the other thing I wasn't even thinking about. That's true. Like, this horrible plane crash, and Buddy Holly's 21 years old, and he's kind of like the epitome of youth, bright future, happy guy. The guy's name is Buddy, for God's sake.
Mm-hmm.
And then they wake up one day, and he's gone. And there's a whole bunch of other people fucking gone. And this is not like YouTube where you could just, like...
Right, right.
Yo, he's gone, bro. Right. You're never going to hear that guy again. Like, that shit is tough for teenagers to deal with, man. You gotta give him an outlet. So, this is like the first song of that kind, probably. I'm going to give this one a silent count.
Yeah, I am too. I am too.
That's just... I hate... There's nothing worse to me than young people having to deal with the death of their friends. Like... There's nothing worse to me than that. I remember the first time it happened to me. There's nothing worse than that to young people. It's just like the ultimate betrayal, man. I hate when I see young people having to deal with that. Like, I'm talking about teenagers.
I never had to deal with that.
Yeah, you're lucky. Because you're young, you feel like you're invincible. You never feel like anything can happen. And then, it's fucking
terrible. I had a friend that was like... I never understood his parents. I had to slap the shit out of this kid. He was driving like a maniac, and he was wrecking so many vehicles. The parents would buy him another vehicle, and they were, I mean, we had to buy our own car, so, you know, I had a 92 Pontiac Grand Am, so it was not something that you were like, yo, this is so cool. They were buying him, which I felt like was a very sporty car, Eclipse. And it was nice, and they kept buying him cars, and he kept driving like a maniac, and he would crash the car, and he had this nylon shirt, and the nylon shirt had all of these, like, because the glass shattered over him, and he would wear this shirt like a friggin' trophy, and then his parents would buy him another car, he'd crash that friggin' car too. I never understood why his parents kept buying him cars and buying his cars. He was over my place, and he was bragging about all this. And I was thinking to myself, right now, this guy thinks he's stunting. You know what I mean? Like, he thinks he's really cool saying all this, and all I can think about is what a moron he is for putting his life on the line. And honestly, it was all those discussions that we had that day that made me say, I am not going to get any closer to this person. And that was that.
And I
don't know what ended up happening to him, because literally he crashed so many cars. I don't know.
And then recently in this timeline, James Dean ended up dying in a car accident.
Unbelievable.
Another one of these, you know, what? So it's a rude awakening. I understand. It's crazy. Like, I understand why the adults, you know, didn't want the song played. I also understand why the kids had to have the song played.
Mm-hmm.
I understand both perspectives. Cars are that's why, like, I'm completely fine with Dorian 16. He could get his license, he could get on that's not even on the radar, and I'm completely good with that.
He brings it up with me, but yeah. I think for me, I'd rather the kids get their permit as soon as possible when they're able to, and drive with us for years so I can see how they are behind the wheel.
I agree with that.
But also, I'm not sure how many accidents happen because somebody made a mistake versus somebody was being stupid. You know, alcohol, drugs, music, driving too fast, all those things I think are major factors into why people get into accidents. I don't think that a lot of accidents happen because somebody was trying to follow the rules of the road and they happened to die in it, you know? So, you know, getting them to understand the seriousness of it while at the same time giving them the training that they need, I think is important. And obviously, I think that they drag their feet on really learning how to do the things that I teach them to do because they don't want to do them. But at the same time, I'm like, is that true? Or do they need an exorbitant amount of time to learn something and learn it well so it's second nature to them to follow the rules of the road without really thinking? Just, you know.
I mean, the saving aspect of it is they have a family member who's a horrible driver.
And no, that's true.
And that person is someone they don't want to be like, so.
That's 100% true. Yeah.
Silent count for me.
Silent count for me as well.
as it is written, you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. With that wonderful reminder, we're out. Then out.
Sorry, out.
Come.
One more song, you guys. Stand By Me is coming up next.
One more song. Stand By Me. Commercial time, bitches.